Hello students, in this series we are going to have a look at evolution of democracy. Specifically, we are going to look at the different models of democracy. In particular, we are going to talk about direct democracy and indirect democracy. What exactly do we mean by direct democracy and what is indirect democracy? So we are going to look at these two core concepts in this particular lecture. Let's begin. So first of all, let us see the meaning of democracy. We have seen this concept before also, but since we are looking at the models of democracy, hence we have to look at the basic and core meaning of the term democracy. See, when we talk about democracy, it literally means the rule of people. Okay, in simple sentence we can say, or in one single sentence we can say, democracy means rule of the people. So here no third party is appointed, directly people rule or people govern themselves. So basically, this concept of democracy is taken from Greek words. As you can see on the screen, these are two words which have been taken from Greek, which is demos and kratos, which means rule of the people. Okay, the word literally means rule of the people. So here, when we say rule of the people, so in regard to this concept, the former president of America, Abraham Lincoln, he has given a particular definition which states that a government is by the people, government is elected by the people, or government is formed by the people. Second, government is being run for the people, right? The government is being run for the people, and the people who are there in government, they are also from the same region, or they are also people. Means here you do not have any monarch, here you do not have any military regime, you do not have any dictator. People themselves are governing or ruling over themselves. So here in simple sentence he is giving the definition. Means former president of America, Abraham Lincoln, is giving the definition which states that democracy means nothing but a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. So people are in the core of this concept. Overall, people are in the core of this concept. People are going to form the government, people are going to be in the government, and people themselves are going to govern the country for the people. Okay, so this is the basic meaning or definition of the concept of democracy. And in short, we can say that the supreme power is vested in the people. No third party will be allowed, only the people will be allowed, and those people are going to govern the country, right? Therefore, people are considered as supreme power in a particular democracy. And it can be directly or indirectly. When you talk about democracy, we have two types of democracies. One is direct democracy, where people rule directly, and second is indirect democracy, where again people rule but rule indirectly. Okay, so we are going to look at that concept as well. So in this concept we can see that there is absence of hereditary rule, there is absence of arbitrariness, there is absence of monarchs, king, queen. They all are absent over here. Only one picture is visible, and that is people. So democracy is all about people. So one may question that where exactly the, you know, concept of democracy started from which country we started this journey from. So if you trace back the history, so you will find that Greek city states, okay, today's Greece, we call it today Greece, At that time, it was called as Greek city-states, and one of them was Athens. Athens is one of the Greek city-state at that time, and even today that location exists, that place exists. So from Athens, this journey of democracy started. The government established over there, people were practicing democracy over there, and that nature of democracy was quite different from that of today. But we can say overall, the concept of or the journey of democracy started from Greek city-state, that is Athens. Now let's look at the meaning of direct democracy. What exactly do we mean by direct democracy? In this concept, people themselves decide their future. Just focus on the words. What I'm saying, that people themselves decide their future. Here, people are directly participating in decision-making process. Okay, there is no mediator, there is no representative, nothing. You don't need any mediator over here. Directly, people are taking participation, or in short, we can say that without any mediator, people themselves are taking their own decision. That system will be known as direct democracy. For instance, let's assume that we want to make a policy in our country which should be applicable throughout the country. So policy making process will be there, and in that policy making procedure, people will go to polling booth and they will cast their vote directly. Means people themselves will decide whether we want this policy or we don't want this policy. So is the case with, or you can say, examples like referendum or plebiscite. These are the best examples in which people can be seen practicing direct democracy. We have famous example of Brexit. Brexit. This is associated with Britain exiting from European Union. Britain escaping from European Union. So a referendum was conducted, and in that referendum, the question was asked whether you want to be the part of European Union anymore or not. And majority people said that we don't want to be the part of European Union. Hence, the decision was very much clear, and ultimately the government had to listen to the people, and ultimately now Britain is no more part of European Union. Okay, so this is the best example of direct democracy, where people directly cast their vote without any mediator. So I hope this concept is very much clear. So here, you don't need any mediator, you don't need any representative. People directly participate and take action. So that's the basic criteria of direct democracy. And if you ask that where do we practice democracy or direct democracy in present world, so yes, we have one example, or we can say this is exceptional example, and that is Switzerland. In Switzerland, direct democracy is practiced. People directly participate in decision-making process in Switzerland. And if you talk about remaining entire world, they are not much practicing direct democracy, but Switzerland is one of the exceptional case. And therefore, we call Switzerland as direct democracy, because people in Switzerland participate directly in decision-making process. We have seen direct democracy. Now let's see at indirect democracy. This is completely opposite to direct democracy. In direct democracy, you have people directly participating in decision-making process, but whereas in indirect democracy, you have somewhat difference. Over here, people are electing their representatives so that they can participate in decision-making process on behalf of people. Okay, simple. You don't have to be, you know, voting all the time. You just elect your one representative, or you just select your one representative, and that one representative will be taking the decision on your behalf. Okay. So in India, we have parliament. In parliament, we have Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So after every 5 years, Indian citizens, they vote for their representatives and they send their representatives in Lok Sabha. And these people who are sitting in parliament, they take decision over the policy formation. They decide whether they want a particular bill or policy or not. If majority members of parliament support a particular bill, then it will be considered as an act of parliament, right? And that bill is converted into act, and that becomes a law of the nation. And if the majority members of parliament says that we don't want this particular bill, and if they are not voting in favor of that particular bill, so in this case, we can say people are rejecting, means people's representatives are rejecting a particular bill, and therefore that bill cannot become act, hence that will not be treated as law of the nation. Okay, so here we saw that you are just voting once in 5 years and you are electing your representative in parliament. They are going to parliament and they will take decision on your behalf. Okay, so it is also called as, for this reason only, indirect democracy is also called as representative democracy, because the decisions are being taken by representatives and not by people directly. Okay, so for that reason it is called as representative democracy. Now when you are taking the decision to elect someone, it also means that you are authorizing them to elect the people amongst them as well on the next position. Like for example, when we are electing the member of parliament, so these member of parliaments are going to select one person as the prime minister. It means what? People have authorized the representatives to select one amongst all of those people as prime minister. Okay, so indirectly we are authorizing our representatives to take action and to take decision. So in this way we can say indirect democracy is more better right now in present scenario. As we can see, majority countries in the world are practicing indirect democracy or representative democracy. The reason is, again, many times it is asked that why don't we practice direct democracy in India? The answer is, direct democracy is quite possible in small countries like Switzerland, or you can say few Nordic countries, but it is highly difficult to implement direct democracy in country like India, where you have huge population. Okay, so just imagine that when we conduct one Lok Sabha election once in 5 years, it takes many months to carry out that election procedure, right? And we have to deploy a huge amount of, we can say, defense personnel's, entire machinery is, you know, involved in electoral process. So in short, we can say that these all things are required. And again, if we conduct, we can say, elections every time, so it will create a kind of burden, economic burden on the country. So if you just keep on spending money on elections, so you will not have money to spend on your economic growth. So this way, what we can say, that huge amount of money will be spent. Not only that, money is a secondary thing. First of all, you have to understand the mentality of the people. Where direct democracy can be implemented? It can be implemented in those countries which are mature enough, where the society is completely civilized, where they understand completely about their fundamental rights and fundamental duties. So if the citizens are completely aware if they are completely aware about their rights and duties, right? In this way, we can say that they are quite mature societies, and therefore it is quite possible for them. But if we try to implement direct democracy in, we can say, less mature societies, that will be quite difficult, because common people, they does not understand diplomacy all the time, right? They do not understand diplomacy all the time, and for this reason, you cannot completely rely on people, and that is the reason sometimes government has to take decision. Okay, so for this reason, we can say direct democracy is quite difficult at this present time. In future, India may bring direct democracy when the situation will be completely in favor of direct democracy, but at present, it is quite difficult on the present scenario. So this was the conclusion, and I hope you got a lot of knowledge out of this video, and thank you for peacefully listening.